Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Clinton Presidential Center. I'm Stephanie Street, and I serve as the Executive Director of the Clinton Foundation. Thank you for attending this historic conference. This event is a first in several respects. It is the first time a president has participated in a declassification event at a presidential library. And it is the first time a presidential library has opened such a large collection of documents before the 25-year automatic declassification date. It is most appropriate that we are here today at the Clinton Center because much of the work in the declassification area that has taken place over the last 18 years is a direct result of Executive Order 12958 signed by President Clinton in April of 1995. Today, the CIA and the Clinton Presidential Library are releasing 341 documents that will shed light on the role intelligence played in the Clinton administration's policy decisions during the 1992 to 1995 Bosnian War. These documents tell three important stories. The first is one of presidential leadership. Armed conflict broke out in Bosnia after declaring independence from Yugoslavia in 1992. The documents depict a newly elected president eager to address the intensifying conflict, which showed no signs of resolution. In 1995, the Clinton administration's international leadership led to the Dayton Accords, which ended fighting in the region. The second story is one of intelligence support. In June 1992, the CIA created the DCI Balkan Task Force to coordinate intelligence support to the policymakers on the rapidly growing Balkan conflict. The Clinton administration, informed by the Balkan Task Force, charted a strategic policy, melding humanitarian aid, economic sanctions, force, and diplomacy. But the path to peace, as these documents will make clear, was treacherous, and the administration relied on accurate intelligence to make difficult choices. The last story is the uniqueness of the documents themselves. This collection represents only a portion of the documents concerning the Bosnian War. It is the youngest collection ever released in the 20-year existence of the CIA's historical review program. Now, before I introduce our first speaker today, I'd like to recognize all of our conference participants. Dr. Madeleine Albright, former Secretary of State and U.S. Ambassador to the UN. Dr. Albright. Sandy Berger, former National Security Advisor to President Clinton. Sandy. Leon Firth, former National Security Advisor to Vice President Gore. Nancy Soderberg, former Deputy National Security Advisor to President Clinton. And General Wesley Clark, former Supreme Allied Commander Europe and Director of Strategic Plans and Policy for the Joint Chiefs of Staff. General Clark. I'd also like to recognize Terry Garner, the director of the Clinton Library. Terry, thank you. Joseph Lambert, the director of the CIA Information Management Services. Skip Rutherford, the dean of the Clinton School of Public Service. Bruce Lindsay, the chairman of the board of the Clinton Foundation. Former Secretary of Transportation Rodney Slater, and Governor Jim Guy Tucker. It is now my pleasure to introduce Dr. John Gannon. Dr. Gannon served as the Deputy Director for Intelligence at the CIA. He was Chairman of the National Intelligence Council and served as Assistant Director of Central Intelligence for Analysis and Production. He led the establishment of the DCI Interagency Balkan Task Force. He headed the White House team in the Department of Homeland Security Transition Planning Office and was the staff director of the House of Representatives Committee on Homeland Security. In 2004, the president awarded him the National Security Medal, the nation's highest intelligence award. Please join me in welcoming Dr. John Gannon.
Thank you, Terry, very much. I would like to also join in thanking some of the wonderful folks who have helped us get here and have supported us since we have gotten here. That Terry Garner, the director of the Clinton Library, Joe Lambert, the director of CIA's Information Management and Services, and David Waltrop, who has been our right-hand supporter for several weeks on this conference. Also, Rob Siebert and Dana Simmons, our archivists here at the library, have been so very helpful, and we much appreciate it. Really, it's an honor for me to be back and to be seated again with people like Secretary Albright, NSC, prominent NSCers like Sandy Berger, Nancy Soderbergh, and Leon Firth, and of course General Wes Clark, who was a Supreme Allied Commander of Europe, but also a very, very active and indispensable member of Dick Holbrooke's team before and during the famous 20-day negotiations that took place at the end of 1995. My key message here this afternoon, coming from the intelligence community and having watched the drama of the Bosnian conflict unfold over all the 3 years that it was most intensive, is that the Balkan Task Force was a success. But it was a success only because it was in two-part harmony with intelligence and policy. The intelligence policy relationship was managed responsibly and productively on both sides. And let me tell you that there's a lot of rumors, or I should say myths, about the intelligence community that I want to address as we proceed here. The first one is that intelligence is best produced and assessed at a distance from policymakers, so the intelligence analysts are not corrupted by the influence of policy. I think that is more or less bunk, and I think what you hear today, and if you look at the documents that have been released, the constructive relationship with policymakers added in every positive way possible to the outcome in Bosnia. The other is a more kind of popular notion about intelligence, and that is that it's kind of intelligence analysis is a sort of a doomsday science that wallows in pessimism. I recall the famous statement by President Lyndon Johnson that when he described intelligence, he evoked the memory of when he was milking a cow on the farm down the Pedernales River as a young man, and he said you would get the bucket filled with pure milk, and then the cow would relieve itself in the milk. And President Johnson said the relief, and he meant relief in a bad way. That was intelligence. So you can imagine how that hurt our feelings. But there's another metaphor that I often hear, and that is the famous Woody Allen comment that we in the intelligence community like to provide options to policymakers. And we look out at the world and say, we are at a crossroads. One path leads to death and destruction, and the other path leads to total annihilation. And we hope you policymakers will be able to have the wisdom to choose the right course. But in fact, in my experience, and the experience I think we're going to relate today on the Balkans, is that intelligence is, when it works well, a collaborative enterprise with vast capabilities to bring to the fight, but also with clear limitations to be understood by leaders who know that they can ask a lot, but not too much, of the intelligence business, and by intelligence leaders who know they can't promise too much. This has to be a workout among reasonable people, and we had that in the Balkans. I also want to say, as a teacher now at Georgetown, when I render a compliment about our Balkan enterprise, there is a historic backdrop here. I think if you look at the experience of other administrations on other issues, like the Kennedy administration on the Cuban Missile Crisis, high marks. Not so much on the Bay of Pigs. President Johnson on the Arab-Israeli Six-Day War in 1967, again, a gold standard. not so much on Vietnam or order of battle or the crisis in the Dominican Republic. The Nixon administration, it is actually easier to talk about successes with the relationship with the intelligence than it is to because there are so few, than there is to talk about the failures. President Carter on the Arab-Israeli peace process, tremendous achievement there, less so on Iran. The Reagan administration, very positive reviews on its Soviet policy, not so much on the Middle East or Iran. The George H.W. Bush administration on, I think, had very impressive achievements in its relationship with intelligence on Eastern Europe and the collapse of communism there, on the USSR, the beginning of the implosion of the Soviet Union, on the Middle East, where it invested in reviving the Middle East peace process, and then on German unification, which I think was a signal success, a tremendous busy and challenging agenda, which that administration did well. I will hold my fire on the George W. Bush administration because I think history will have to review that, and I'm not confident that the grades will be very high there. The Balkan Task Force was established in 1992 for a very simple reason. If all of you have ever made a phone call, and by the way, you make a phone call to the intelligence community, you have a whole bunch of technical agencies, analytic agencies. If you have a pressing need and you want to get that intelligence community to help you, you got to know how to make it work. So that when we talked about establishing the Balkan Task Force, we knew the complexity of the issues in the Balkans were virtually unprecedented in most of our experience. This was going to be a tough road to hoe. So we wanted to simplify the relationship with the policy community. So we wanted to, if you've made a telephone call where you need a service right away and you call and you get that nice electronic lady who tells you, we will give you six options and you pick one, and then, you know, six or seven buttons that you push, you may not get help. Well, we wanted to eliminate that kind of delay and make it personal so that a person could call the Balkan Task Force and get a response. And we discovered that the effect within the intelligence community was that our analysts became much more aware of the mission that our policymakers had, the broad issues that they had to cover beyond the kind of narrow disciplines that these folks came from. And it was really a delight to watch on the collection side, where a policymaker would have a critical issue where they needed help from a technical collector, and one of our Balkan task force folks could actually put the person in contact with the collection agency, so you could refine the requirements so that the policymaker could get what they needed. So again, bringing all of this into a collaborative relationship, I think, was the beginning and ultimately the maturation of that process was responsible for a lot of the success that we enjoyed. But I do want to emphasize that this, and I always resist talking about the intelligence community in isolation, because none of this success would have been possible without the engagement on the policy side. Dick Holbrooke obviously was a strong influence and almost on a day-to-day basis in what we did. I've described Dick as the wind in our sails, but sometimes the hurricane at our picnic. He was usually ahead of where the intelligence was and wanted it to go further. So he was a great demandeur of intelligence. I wish sometimes he shared a little more of the information on his side more than he did, but I understood that there were reasons that he held back. But the rest of his team, and I do want to say, the rest of his team, Dick was a bit flamboyant, maybe, in the way that he conducted himself, and I don't mean that in a negative sense, but he had a team that was a bunch of modest workhorses. And people like Bob Fraser, Nelson Drew, and then Joe Kruzel, who came from DOD to join Dick's team. And then beyond that particular team, Walt Slocum at DOD, Chris Hill, who was a part of Dick's team. National Security Team, always Tony Lake and Sandy Berger, Sandy Virchow, Nancy Soderberg. These were all folks who made it very, not to say they didn't put demands on us, not to say that they were not critical at times of what we delivered, but they were always collegial, respectful, and they made it work better than it would have. Leadership is so critical to making that intelligence policy relationship work, and we had that leadership from the National Security Council and the Clinton team overall. The production that the Balkan Task Force put out went across a range that was almost unprecedented in my career. We had to follow the state of conflict, which was always of great interest to people, but we also had to assess a very complicated set of leaders with Alija Izetbegović in Sarajevo, Franjo Tuđman in Zagreb, and Slobodan Milosevic, who's probably the best known of the three. But very difficult personalities, very difficult relationships, and I think right down to Dayton, it was extremely difficult for the policy side to deal with those leaders and for us to provide support. But working together with that very reasonable group of people on the on Dick Holbrooke's team and the National Security Council team, I think you'll see in the documents that have been released thus far a great deal of mutual support and collaboration. So we had also had to deal with particular relationships of countries like Russia, Hungary, Turkey, and Greece in the Balkans, and that was a complicated challenge to deal with. We started off with a kind of dismal order of battle situation that we had to mature, and actually did a pretty good job of doing. We had an arms embargo. We had econ and financial sanctions. We had to provide constant support for mapping, and we did actually produce some pretty good cartographic technology to help with the effort. And even on meteorology, because in the humanitarian support area, it was so important to be able to predict weather, and we tried, sometimes got some criticism for the science behind it, but it was helpful. I can't even recall when we were trying to determine whether humanitarian need would be in Jeppa. We actually used imagery to look at the rooftops as the winter came on, and made a determination that where the rooftop showed melted snow, there were probably people living there. A crude measure, but we had to use every tool we had, and that was just one of them. So if you look at the documents that have been released, and if you in my own recollection of the work that we did on the Balkans, there tends to be a guarded and kind of skeptical regard. It wasn't President Johnson's soiled milk, but it was cautious. And the argument I would make there is because the issues were that difficult. Caution was called for in almost every case. So when we looked at the launch of the UN Protective Force, UNPROFOR, in 1992, to the monitoring of the arms embargo and the ceasefire in the former Yugoslavia, to the early stages of the UN's economic sanctions, which were imposed in May of 1992, to the EU's Carrington peace plan in early 1992, to the Vance Owen peace proposal a year later, to schemes for the delivery of relief supplies, which were a constant source of discussion within the policy arenas, to the UN's declaration in 1993 of the six Muslim safe areas, Sarajevo, Tuzla, Bihać, Srebrenica, Jeppa, and Garajda, and to the contact groups, that was the US, UK, France, Germany, and Russia, the chances of their plans for restoring peace process in 1994. When you look at all those things that we covered, there was a skepticism because we were reflecting the real obstacles that I think the policymakers were facing. But in retrospect, I would want people to know, as I do, that the Balkan Task Force and the people running it pulled out all the stops to bring all the capabilities of intelligence to help policymakers to overcome those obstacles. So we may have a reputation for skepticism, but we should also have a reputation for doing everything we can to defeat those who are skeptical. I want to just mention quickly two papers that were done. A famous paper done back in October of 1990, a national intelligence estimate on the National Intelligence Council, which I had the privilege of heading later on. It's predicted that Yugoslavia would cease to be a functioning state within ultimately 2 years. And that was a kind of controversial, not controversial statement within the intelligence community. It did generate some conflict on the policy side, but not really much, because the Bush administration was really not. I did not notice that the Bush administration was determined in any way to intervene in the Balkans for the few months that they had remaining in office. But it had a second key judgment, which said that there is little the United States and its European allies can do to preserve Yugoslav unity. And that is where, when I was interviewed by a study done on this back in the early 2000s, my comment was that is the kind of statement that we really need to look at carefully as producers of intelligence. Because, in fact, it was wrong. The United States did intervene, and the United States did. Bosnia is an independent state today. It would not be had the United States not had intervened with European assistance in the way that it did. So we didn't really look at alternatives in a serious way, and partly because we weren't being asked to do so by an administration that was not going to intervene. So the key issue for us has to be that we do need to look at those, and I think we're doing it much better today. Because there were issues of spillover we didn't really look at. So if we just left Yugoslavia alone, it would have had impact not just on the six republics of Yugoslavia, but into Hungary at a time when we were dealing with the restructuring, really, of the whole security architecture of Europe. Border issues would have been affected. You would have seen the countries of the Balkan region and the European region affected by the disaster that would have occurred. So the intervention ended up being a very constructive policy to take, and I think we do now look much more rigorously at alternatives. But a second one I want to mention is a case of when I was a director for European analysis, a couple of analysts came to me. One was an imagery analyst. That was before the NGA was established, and they still worked closely with us in the Directorate of Intelligence. And Ted Holt was his name, and he was a very dedicated imaging analyst who, on his own initiative, working with a Directorate of Intelligence analyst, decided to go through all the archival imagery of Bosnia. And the goal was to see what that imagery would tell us about the accountability for ethnic cleansing. And when they finished the work, it showed that if the pattern, going through several hundred villages in Bosnia, was that the Orthodox churches and institutions were preserved, Muslim and in some cases Catholic institutions were destroyed. And the result of that assessment was that we asserted that about 90% of the ethnic cleansing was really the responsibility of Serbs. Now, within my own analytic community, there were some people who said, hey, we know this. This isn't news. But it had a great impact, and I knew it had an impact, partly because I was getting calls and complaints, some from the military side, but from others also, because there was a, if you looked at the state of debate as I saw it at that time, there was sort of a view of a plague on all their houses. This is the Balkans. It's a cauldron of historic hatreds. We can't do anything about it, and we shouldn't be intervening. Well, this was imagery is largely circumstantial evidence, but it was quite persuasive to a number of people, including Dick Holbrook. When I brought the study over to him, when we still had it in slides and some talking points before we had actually published it, I mean, Dick brought us into his conference room on the sixth floor state, took down some paintings in a very dramatic fashion, then called everybody in because he knew where it was going. And he saw that not as brilliant analysis, but as something that was going to be useful in a debate. So he said to me, and I remember it precisely, he leaned over to me and said, John, I know what you've got here is true, but I want you to take it over to the Pentagon. We did take it over to the Pentagon. Of course, Walt Slocum, and extremely receptive to the area. And I remember Joe Kruzel, highly complimentary of the work that was done there. So that's an example of this was not a dramatic strategic piece of work. It was a very much a here and now look at where we are, but doing it with the benefit of imagery in a way that really I did think at least influenced. It wasn't determinative, but it was a positive influence on the debate that ultimately led to the to a resolution of in Bosnia. But I want to say that probably there is no story that tested the intelligence policy relationship more than the UN imposed sanctions regime on Serbia and Montenegro, which were imposed in May 1992 and lasted through the Dayton Accords in 1995. The unrelenting challenge to policymakers to monitor and enforce this complex economic and financial sanctions regime, and to transform it from a struggling marginal influence on outcomes, which really that's what it was when the Clinton administration came into power, to a major factor in driving Milosevic's shift to the conference table, required sustained intelligence support at every turn. And I want to emphasize that if you talk to, as I did, to our analysts, and to, I think a lot of folks on the policy side too, in 1992, there wasn't a lot of confidence that sanctions were really going to be able to make a difference. In the end, they made a tremendous difference. They were a huge lever to get Milosevic to the conference table. He wanted oil and gas in Belgrade at the end of 1995. And I think if you read Dick Holbrooke's memoir, I think he actually wanted relief from sanctions more than he was committed to the greater Serbia and with regard to the Krajina in Croatia. So the success of the sanctions effort on the part of intelligence, I think it owes a lot to three things, really. To Leon Firth and the very rigorous, patient, sustained effort he had on a daily basis. We had daily meetings on sanctions. And the way he structured the response and also structured the effort. He had established a task force involved, including state, treasury, DOD, commerce, customs, border control, and CIA. And that married nicely with the Balkan task force, which was bringing together all the intelligence assets. But I will tell you that it did require the leadership of someone like Leon to get it to work. But this, for the intelligence side, it required a full-scale, what we call multi-int. That means all of your collection assets and all source analytic, meaning you had regional analysts, economic analysts, financial analysts, together on a daily basis to bring about the result that was achieved on those sanctions. And they became a model of success, and I think actually changed, in my judgment, changed the view among a lot of our policy community about the potential effectiveness of sanctions. I just want to say something briefly about Srebrenica. I think we took some hits, and this is 1995 was a year of what I would call a year of the convergence of both triumph and tragedy, and one of the great tragedies was, of course, the ethnic Serb assault on the safe area of Srebrenica, where about 8,000 Muslim men and boys were killed, and over 20,000 women and children were expelled. In just a brief period, really for over a week, about from 6 to 16 July in 1995. There were questions about, you know, how could this have happened? Why couldn't intelligence have predicted it? I will leave others to speak, I mean, perhaps even more knowledgeably from the policy side about this. But my view was that, well, I can say with total confidence that we produced, that we disseminated intelligence as we had it. And we were dealing with the Dutch peacekeepers there who, in my judgment, kind of played down the threat. But the simple fact is that when it came time to, when we saw an impending crisis coming, as I saw it, I thought our policy side worked overtime to try to get collaboration among Europeans to do something about it. There was a tremendous fear that I detected anyway among Europeans of taking military action that would have endangered their nationals who were already deployed in various places in Bosnia. So when I look back on it, where do you assign accountability for a regrettable and tragic situation in Srebrenica? My own conclusion, and it's purely a personal one, is that I think it goes with the Serb, and I'm including not ethnic Serb in Bosnia, but Serbs out of Belgrade, politicians and military leaders who recognized, which was clear to all of us, the fragility of the international peacekeeping commitment to the safe areas. And they made a callous and calculated decision to cross that delicate line and to commit horrendous war crimes. I think that's where I would leave it. What I saw, both on the intelligence side and on the policy side, was people who were working furiously to try to deal with that situation. We simply didn't have adequate intelligence on the ground. We did not have, and we did not have an international network that was at the ready to increase support to the safe areas, and that that vulnerability was exploited in a horrendous way by the Serbs. Then the Krajina, it was an interesting case in 1995, in August, again, just a few days in August, when the Croatians expelled a large population of ethnic Serbs who were living in that part of what had been Croatia. And that was an interesting debate that we had with Dick Holbrooke, because Dick was insistent on the need to encourage the Serbs, the Croats, to proceed with that expulsion. What I will say about the intelligence side, and this is just to show you the kind of conundrum we get into. I think on the intelligence side, we saw a Serb military capability that was wrong, actually, in around the Knin area, that would actually repel, that would fight against the Croatians. That didn't happen. The ethnic Serbs ran furiously out of the Krajina. We also were concerned about the regular Yugoslav army coming in, and we also were concerned that they might have had some missiles that could have been used actually to assault Americans in places like Zagreb. So this was a case, and Dick does mention in his memoirs twice, that we failed to predict this. But from my perspective, it really wasn't prediction, it was risk assessment. And what we said and what he said were properly weighed, I think, by the policy side, and the decision was made that, in his argument, that this would clean the map up in a way that would lead more rapidly to peace is probably the right decision. But looking back, sometimes you can't find a better way you would have done it yourself with the limited intelligence we had. And I think the warning that we articulated at the time was appropriate, even though we were wrong in some of our in judgments. Then let me talk just briefly about the Mujahideen, Iranians and other Mujahideen forces that came into Bosnia. That was covered very well by intelligence from early in the 1992 period right through 1995. I made a conscious effort to try to distinguish among all the Mujahideen fighters who had come into Bosnia. Among the, we wanted to identify the Iranian IGRC, that's the Army of the Guardians of the Islamic Revolution, some of the really tough guys, and then Iranian intelligence officers versus military folks. I think we did a pretty good job of that. But this, I do get the question, well, why didn't we shout louder about this? And we got that from Congress really toward the end of the conflict, not during it. And I think the issue was, I think, that partly the Mujahideen was actually assisting the Bosnian Muslims in a way and helping to balance their power with other forces that actually was not in violation of U.S. objectives at the time. And also, when we looked at the order of battle, we judged that they were never a decisive force in the conflict. And of course, but there was a very wise policy decision in the period of the Dayton Accords to require that those fighters would be removed as a condition of the Accords. And President Izetbegovic pledged to do that. And we did monitor that, not always with total satisfaction, but we did monitor it. So the last thing I want to say is on the War Crimes Tribunal, because this is to me a very interesting issue. Because if you look at a War Crimes Tribunal, it's not difficult to understand why such a tribunal might be controversial in an intelligence agency that is asked by its government to assume the risk of working with Balkan officials who might, with the help of that same government, become targets for prosecution at The Hague. This reality, notwithstanding, the intelligence community can't provide outstanding support for the larger USG effort on war crimes. David Sheffer, with whom I had considerable contact, was Secretary Albright's choice in 1993 to lead the effort to establish a war crimes tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, and he eventually became President Clinton's ambassador at large for war crimes issue. He has written eloquently about his great frustration initially in getting cooperation from across the government, including from the Intelligence Community. But he concedes that by the time of Srebrenica, and with a lot of help from then Deputy Director George Tenet, and getting a lot of help from the Balkan Task Force also, that situation was turned around. And I can say, having watched the people, and I mentioned Jim Finkel as one of the analysts, they pursued that issue with total professional commitment, and in many cases a passion that really did deliver, I think, some very positive results. So in conclusion, let me just say that on the Balkan Task Force, I think, represented a major successful effort to integrate intelligence collection and analytic capabilities for the benefit of policymakers dealing with what we saw as a high level of complexity and uncertainty amidst rapidly deteriorating conditions in a volatile region of Europe. It also provided an innovative platform for a continuous real-time policy input to drive intelligence priorities and to refine collection requirements for optimum impact. The BTF, coming in the wake of the Iraq Task Force, which was much more controversial in terms of its performance in the first Gulf War, actually was asking for a level of collaboration across agencies unprecedented in the history of the intelligence community. And I think a lot of the credit goes to the policy folks who work with us, but that level of collaboration, in fact, was achieved. The BTF's relationship with policymakers remained strong, and I watch this every day, even when there was clear disagreement on important issues like the Croat invasion of the Ukraine in 1995 and other issues that came up, because people were ready to collaborate. The early investment in collaboration on the part of the policymakers of the Clinton administration and the intelligence community paid off in the resolution of minor difficulties before they could become big problems. And the BTF, as I look back on it now, and I think it's evident in a lot of the documents you're going to read, remained committed to helping policymakers develop options and reduce the uncertainty they faced in making decisions. The BTF, I'm proud to say, saw itself as an integral part of a U.S. government team. So now is, stopping my own comments, it's going to be my pleasure now to introduce Nancy Soderberg, who is the Deputy National Security Advisor, number three, but actually she was number three, but she was actually number one in terms of the people who liked people from the intelligence side over to the policy side. Nancy was unflappable, always calm. She could levy some pretty heavy requirements on us, but she always did it with such class and sympathy for the work of intelligence folks. She went on to become U.S. Representative for Special Political Affairs at the U.S. Mission to the U.N. With the rank of ambassador. She did some very important work on Northern Ireland. She was a foreign policy advisor to both Ted Kennedy and, I think, Mayor Bloomberg. Right, so interesting combination of folks. And she has written a couple books, and good books, and she is now working on the president's declassification effort, so she knows a lot about those documents. So welcome, Nancy, great to be working with you again.
We have an exciting panel for you to give you firsthand chance to hear from those authors of the many documents that you've had out here. We're going to have a brief discussion from Madeleine Albright, Wes Clark, Sandy Berger, and Leon Firth. They've already been introduced, so I won't take your time in doing that again. We're going to hear from each of them, have a little discussion with them, and then take a few questions from the audience, and then wrap it up around 3 o'clock, at which point we'll have a short break, and then the president will come. So let me invite the panel to come up. this on? Well, first, we want to thank the Clinton Library and obviously Stephanie Street, and it's great to see so many old friends. I think the Dayton peace process is something that we're all very proud of to have been part of, and it really stands as President Clinton's, one of his many lasting legacies. And the legacy is that today Bosnia is a multi-ethnic and democratic state. And I think that the team here on stage deserves really a large chunk of that credit, and most importantly, President Clinton. But the unsung hero in this, I think, is also the intelligence community. If you look at the over 2,000 pages that have been released, I have to have hats off to the Historical Collections Division of the CIA, chairing another declassification effort. It's not easy to do what you all have done, so I want to just give you all a round of applause for what you've done. It's extraordinary, so thank you for that. And I just would ask Joe Lambert to stand, because he's really deserves the credit for today's conference. And were it not for the government shutdown, we'd have him up on stage. But he's a private citizen today. So, but this is really, Stephanie mentioned this, this is the youngest collection of documents ever released. And that makes us feel a lot younger, since this was almost two decades ago. But I think what you heard from John Gannon is just how hard all of this is to actually do, and how many hours went into supporting the policymakers, and how important it was for the policymakers to have direction and a conversation with the intelligence community. And when they work together, it really makes a huge difference. Reading through these newly released documents, it brings me back to around the corner in the 1992 campaign, where the headquarters were not far from here. And I remember very distinctly then candidate Clinton, and actually candidate Vice President to be Gore, calling into the headquarters wanting to do more on Bosnia. The instinct of the President and the Vice President was, we inherited a situation where the U.S. had real interests. The previous administration had said, we don't have a dog in this fight. Well, the President absolutely thought we did, and worked from the day he took office to move that forward. So what I wanted to do today was walk you through, with the participants on stage with me, of what it was like, both to try and put the United States in a stronger leadership position, how the President did that, how his senior officials did that, and also how they use the intelligence. So I wanted to start with Sandy Berger, who is Deputy National Security Advisor in the first term and National Security Advisor in the second term. But he was also one of the first people on President Clinton's 92 campaign. So he saw the evolution from well before even the President had won election. And he saw firsthand how the President wanted to lift the embargo, get involved, have U.S. leadership. And reading through these documents, they're really fascinating. They talk about how do we have next steps early on, and the possibility of a Serbian conditional yes. And what would we do if that happens? Would we put troops in if it succeeds? The good news was, if it succeeded, great, but the bad news was we had to put troops in there, and all sorts of debates with Congress about lifting the arms embargo. I think probably the most interesting memos for me are the lead up to the Bosnian end games, where it leading up till July of 1995, where the President finally decided he was going to take charge and drove a process of the marriage of force and diplomacy that ended up in the Dayton Peace Accords. And Sandy, in July of 95, you write to your colleagues, including to Madeleine and to Leon, a eyes-only memo. In other words, they weren't able to make copies of it to their staff. And it's extremely sensitive and held closely. So this is one of the crown jewels of the intelligence documents. And it's right after the fall of Srebrenica, where we're talking about perhaps UNPROFOR, the UN operation, would collapse, and contemplating airstrikes, basically jettisoning the European effort and taking it into our hand. And it's the beginning of the end. And I would wonder if you could pick up that story and kind of walk us through what happened and how leadership was a key element to the win at the end.
Thanks, Nancy. The Bosnian story, I think, is compelling and interesting and quite relevant even today as you read it. And maybe before I get to 95, it would be useful, I think, to put it in the context of what went before, because it only makes sense, I think, in that context. As a candidate in 1992, Governor Clinton took quite a strong posture on Bosnia. As Nancy said, the Bush administration, coming off the Gulf War, basically said it had no dog in that fight. President, then Governor Clinton, thought we did, both for humanitarian reasons and because he thought we had a strategic interest in a conflict in the middle of Europe. He gets elected. There is a rather intense debate, which my colleagues up here will remember, within the administration about what the proper course is. Our military folks were quite opposed to a robust posture. They did not think that air power could be used for limited purposes. The doctrine of overwhelming force that was prevailing at that time did not allow for this kind of activity. And so the president basically decided he would send Secretary Christopher off to Europe to try to convince the Europeans to lift the arms embargo against the Bosnians and use air power to strike against the Serbians. The Europeans, he hit a stone wall. The Europeans said, this is a European problem, go away. This is not an American problem, and stay out of our business, essentially. And for the next 2 years, it was a very frustrating situation with on-again, off-again negotiations, with six instances where air power was used in a limited way for pinprick strikes, for various peace plans that were never viable, growing brutality from the Serbs, atrocities, and are not really being able to push the process forward. And that leads up to the moment that Nancy set up in the question. In July of, right before this moment, and I know Madeline will talk more about this, and John did as well, the Serbs went into Srebrenica, one of the so-called safe areas in Bosnia, supposedly safe areas. The Dutch were protecting it. The Dutch fled. They called it airstrikes. They got there 3 days later and destroyed two tanks. And 8,000 Bosnians were massacred and thrown into mass graves. And Madeline, I hope, will pick up that story when she speaks. This was all more than we could bear. I was in my office in mid-July, and I got a call that the president would like to see me on the putting green. Now, that was a little disconcerting, because I didn't think he was wanted me to challenge me to a game of pitch and putt. So I went out, and Nancy was there, and Mike McCurry. And that morning, the day before, Chirac had proposed a 10,000-person rapid reaction force that could go into Bosnia and rescue people. It was totally impractical, but it was action. It was proactive. And the president said to us, why don't you give me better ideas? Why don't I get new options? At least Chirac has new ideas. So that was our marching orders. And it basically turns out that, in fact, we were working on an endgame strategy that Tony Lake and a small group were working on at that point. And this accelerated that process. And the end game strategy essentially was that the United States and President Clinton would take over the Bosnian enterprise, in a word. It involved one last high-level negotiation with Milosevic and the Muslims, an offer on the table, take it or leave it. If Milosevic turned it down, we would go to the UN and push the UN force out of the country, We would then lift the arms embargo, arm the Bosnians, train them, and use air power. Most importantly, the president committed to put 25,000 American troops into Bosnia to enforce a peace. Now, you have to understand something. At this point, 3% of the American people thought that Bosnia was an important U.S. foreign policy interest. And the president's approval rating on foreign policy was 34%. This was not an expedient decision for the president. He believed that we had to act. It also flipped the decision-making process on its head, because usually you move a decision up from the deputies to the principals to the president. This turned it upside down. We took it to the president, he decided it. We then moved it down to the principals, and I must say, the only principals who approved this were Madeline and Leon and the NSC folks, not anybody else at the time. And General Shalikashvili, who was working this very, very hard with his military colleagues. We then dispatched Tony Lake to go to the Europeans with a very different posture, which we called tell, don't ask. And the posture was, we're going to do this, with you or without you. And the Europeans said, with us. And so went to Milosevic. He turned it down. A few weeks later, he bombed Sarajevo. And what began was Operation Deliberate Force, 11 days of intensive bombing of Serbia, 3,000 sorties, 60 targets. At one point, the UN asked us to pause the bombing. We paused it for 2 days, went back to Milosevic. Dick Holbrooke sent a classic Holbrooke message, send bombs for peace. The bombing continued, and after 11 days, you must have been with Dick. West was an invaluable part of that team. Milosevic agreed to a ceasefire, and then 2 weeks later, Dayton Peace Conference at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, where Holbrooke, General Clark, and others, in a really extraordinary, brilliant negotiation, hammered out what became the Dayton Peace Accord. So I mean, the basic lesson here, it seems to me, I mean, there are a lot of lessons in terms of lashing force to diplomacy in contradiction to the posture that some people had taken at the beginning of this process. But I think it's also a lesson about American leadership. Where we lead, generally, countries follow. We are the big dog. And that leadership starts with the president. President Clinton led here. And that leadership, I think, led to ending the war in Bosnia, which I think is an extraordinary legacy of his presidency.
And just before we go to Leon, I wanted to just ask you to comment on the role of intelligence through that process.
This is the best example in my 8 years in the Clinton administration, 4 years in the Carter administration, of the intelligence community working with the policymakers. It was really seamless, and John, you understated, I think. It works best when the policymakers ask the right questions, and the intelligence community is close enough to the policy that they know what the policymakers need. And there was a daily video conference at the working level, and whether the whole range from understanding the extraordinarily complex dynamic of Bosnia, the religious, historical dynamic, to monitoring the flows of arms and people, to the economic embargo, which Leon was like a puppet master, just a brilliant exercise of using sanctions to squeeze at the micro level. I mean, basically, who were Milosevic's buddies? And what did they buy for lunch? And how do we keep that out of their hands? It was unbelievable in a cooperation between Leon and the Intelligence Committee, to war crimes, to at Dayton, and Wes could talk more about this, very sophisticated cartography. It was all about maps at Dayton, where were the lines going to be drawn, to meteorology, so that we were able to know what the winter was going to look like in Bosnia for humanitarian reasons. You know, John spoke about the Iranians and the Mujahideen that had infiltrated into Bosnia, getting rid of those. I mean, it was really extraordinary. It's the classic case of cooperation.
Thank you. Let me now bring in Leon Firth, who was Vice President Gore's National Security Advisor and really drove sanctions policy to a level that has never been matched before or since in terms of garnering the international effort to try and have sanctions take a bite and to make sure that our policy worked. And his work really did change the course of history in the Balkans. I don't think his story has been told well enough, so I'm glad we have a chance to talk about it today. In Secretary Albright's oral history, she quotes Ambassador Richard Holbrooke calling sanctions the crown jewel of the policy. And this is the king of sanctions. He is a quiet man. He would only speak when had something interesting to say, and often very unique. And we all remember those meetings after meetings. And one of the memos was from you, Leon, to the principals in March of 95, so about 6 months before the end game, saying that the sanctions enforcement is gradually degenerating. And you say that the key question is whether it makes sense for the U.S. government to press others to strengthen sanctions enforcement to push Milosevic towards the end of a negotiated settlement. And your memo talks about problem areas like flagging European support for sanctions, fuel still reaching the Serbs through Italy, Greece, Serb exports through Macedonia earning hard currency. So talk to us a little bit about how you did it, how you drove the most important sanctions enforcement ever, what your relationship with the intelligence community was, and how, as Milosevic changed his strategies, did the intelligence change with it so that you could make sure that these sanctions were as loophole-free as possible?
Generally speaking, Nancy.
I don't think it's on, I think.
Generally speaking, I can remember three questions in a row, and that was five. So you're gonna have to remind me by choosing from what I forget, which is still important to answer. I had a peculiar background coming into this this situation. My first assignment as a Foreign Service officer, because the U.S. balance of payments were running in the wrong way, was to be assigned to the Bureau of Intelligence and Research. In the State Department, while all the unmarried officers from my class were sent to Vietnam. I learned an awful lot about the craft of intelligence from the work that I had to do in that office. Later, I wound up on the staff of the House Select Committee on Intelligence and learned an awful lot about how the system works and how to draw it forward in terms of willingness to collaborate. And then wound up, fast forward another decade or so, with a mandate that the principals gave. And without that mandate, everything else would have been impossible. And I remember very vividly, I showed up for a routine morning meeting and all of you were present. And I was informed that you wanted me to take over the job of trying to improve the effectiveness of the sanctions in the U.S. government and with other countries. And I asked, you may remember this, that you each communicate with the secretariats in your departments to tell them, in effect, I was friend, not foe, and they were to collaborate. What happened was that meant that instead of taking 2, 3, 4, 5 days to coordinate a cable, to get out into the world. It took a couple of hours, which meant that the responsiveness of the U.S. government to intelligence suddenly moved to the point where we could get ahead of the game that others were playing. But our ability to understand that game was driven by what we were given by the intelligence services. So this was collaboration with double strength caps, because our system got behind a mission of making these things work. We had the material in the form of intelligence data, and we had full collaboration all the way up through the principals level to respond rather than to watch people run circles around us as they moved money or other kinds of material into the Serbian war effort. So that's really the secret of how that worked. The other, of course, was to realize that until we were ready to use force, this was the cutting edge of the American response to what we saw going on in the Balkans. And in our many meetings on that subject, it always struck me that on top of or behind all of the logistical and technical elements of the debate and the foreign policy and national security issues, there was a group of distinguished Americans in the room, and they were wrestling with what was right to do in the name of the American people in the presence of something that we all felt was not acceptable. So those are the ultimate drivers behind the effectiveness. The other was the nature of the collaboration with the intelligence services. The basic rule that I learned throughout all of my contacts with that world is that the quality of the intelligence you get is a function of the quality of the questions you ask. The relationship between so-called consumers and producers of intelligence cannot be passive if it is to be the best that it can be. It has to be active. It requires that policymakers not regard intelligence producers as if they were selling a utility. Flip the switch, the lights are on. It has to be understood as a dynamic and creative art. It has to be treated with respect, above all, while you do not want intelligence producers to tell policymakers what they think the policy should be. You do want intelligence producers in the room when it is being formed, so that they can go out and find the information that policy needs in order to succeed. So there are rules of the road in this relationship that we observed. And the result was a highly motivated intelligence system that went out not only waiting to be told what to look for, but was out there foraging for what it already understood we were going to need and producing it, very often ahead of time. So these are human dimensions to a highly complex and technical process, but they resulted in that process, I think, surging ahead of the actual need of policy to produce the information out of which you can create new solutions and recognize the way in which problems are evolving. That was your last point, I think. And the ability, remember that we were dealing with a highly intelligent and reactive foe during this time, and we were often dependent upon the intelligence community to tell us when the tactics were changing so that we could adjust what we were doing in order to be able to keep ahead of the curve and make the sanctions work as a means to pressure Milosevic into dropping his policies and finally negotiating.
This is how Leon was in meeting after meeting. He says, I don't remember, and then hits it out of the ballpark, all 5 points. So.
Well, once you jump off the diving board, you remember plenty.
let me turn now to General Wesley Clark, who was a key military advisor throughout this period, and obviously capping the career as Supreme Allied Commander. And during which the Kosovo campaign in 1999, he was a recipient of some of our absolute best intelligence, so conducting over 10,000 airstrikes against Serb targets in Operation Allied Force, really saved Kosovo. And any time he wants to run for president, you could do Kosovo down, hands down. They love the president in Kosovo, and particularly Wes Clark. But for 78 days, that went on, and not one Allied fatality. It's really a stunning example of Wes's leadership and the marriage of force and diplomacy to save lives. But take us back to Bosnia. You were at the Pentagon at the time, and then on Dick Holbrooke's team, and with the team that was actually on Mount Igman when we lost Bob Fraser, Joe Kruzel, and Nelson Drew. Is Sandy here? No, Sandy was, yeah. Sandy, there, could you please stand up? This is Nelson Drew's wife, Sandy. And those three are very much in our minds every time we think about this valiant effort to restore peace there and save Bosnia. But Wes was on that trip and understands from the difficult periods of leading up to the end of the war in Bosnia how important from a military standpoint the intelligence was. And we'd like to hear from the military perspective of both the need for leadership in marrying force and diplomacy in the Bosnia conflict, but also from a military standpoint, how important the intelligence piece of that was.
Yeah, well, I was, there's the president, there's the principals committee where Sandy and Leon and Madeline were, and then there's the deputies committee, and then there's the rest of us who were out there. So I came in as the J5, I was a 3-star, and I didn't understand how this system worked. Honestly, I came out of the 1st Cavalry Division. I'd always heard about Washington and so forth, but it's kind of intimidating to come in there.
Explain for the audience what J5 is. Not
the J5 is one of 8 staff officers who work for the Joint Chiefs of Staff, for the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The chairman, General Shalley, should be here, and I really miss Shalley. He was the real brains behind this, and I miss Dick Holbrooke, and I want to say that, because they were two real leaders who are responsible for so much of what the success of the policy was. Shalley, because he set the tone for the civil-military relationship. And he was born in Poland. He was always a bit of an odd duck in the military. He had a name that was unpronounceable and unspellable, because everybody's named Smith and Brown, and then there was this guy with Shalikashvili. And he had a big brother who was a special forces guy. And he was an artilleryman, and he spoke with an accent. And he seemed very smart, but he wasn't part of the mainstream. And people were shocked. All of a sudden, he was picked to be the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. And he wasn't a good old boy. He actually thought about things. He really did. And the most important thing about Shalley was he tried to make it work. What the president did, he not only said what the military view is, but he took the thoughts of the principles and worked with those thoughts and tried to craft military support for those thoughts. I think that's fair, right? I mean, he was constructive. And I would go with him to meetings. As the J5, I went to countless meetings with him on everything from arms control to whatever else. And he was acutely sensitive to trying to understand the nuances of the issues and make things work. And nowhere was that more clear than in Bosnia. Bosnia, it was a tough lift. Because we came out of Vietnam and we don't like wars, and in the United States Army especially. And then we went to the Gulf War and we had to force General Schwarzkopf to take 7th Corps. And so we ended up with 500,000 troops there. It was the epitome of what General Colin Powell called was decisive force. And then we come to Bosnia. And it looks a lot like Vietnam. I mean, there's people fighting and you can't tell the good guys from the bad guys. And you can't spell the names. They don't have any vowels in them. You don't know how to pronounce them. It's in a place that nobody knows. And so, as Barry McCaffrey testified, my predecessor's J5, it would take 400,000 troops to deal with this problem. And that wasn't terribly helpful. And I think that was one of the issues that you all had to deal with when he put that number out on the table. So I got there in the spring of 1994, and I had a lot of things on my plate, and I noticed I had to submit this paper to go into the interagency working group that would eventually make its way to the deputies committee, and through that perhaps some issues would be extracted to the principals committee. And nobody on my staff had ever been to Bosnia. They didn't know what they were talking about. I mean, they were reading good intelligence, John, don't get me wrong. And I got a lot of information from it, but nobody could tell me what the military dimension was. So I talked to my buddy, the J3, Jack Sheehan, because he was actually doing most of the Bosnia stuff. I said, Jack, I'd like to go over there and learn this and see it. He says, go ahead, but you got to understand that anybody who gets involved in Bosnia, it will ruin your career and you'll probably get fired. So not only did you have the problem in the Pentagon of wanting to use a lot of force, you also had a lot of people jumping back from the problem. And so this did make it difficult, but we did get the options done, and I did get over there, and it almost did ruin my career after I traded hats with Mladic, and I had Senator Dole write the president say I should be fired, and I think Sandy may have helped me on that and kept me in my position. It was a rocky road, I will say that. It was funny. Charlie had told me about a month before I left, he was complaining one day in his office, says, anytime you want to do anything in this town, you have to be prepared to take the heat for it. He'd been criticized in Congress. Boy, I came back and I forget about Congress. It was all over the Washington Post that I disobeyed some ambassador's judgment not to speak to Mladic. And of course, I'd never been told not to speak to Mladic. I would never have disobeyed anybody's direction like that, knowingly. But as we moved through this process, it came to the summer of 1995, and they asked me for some input to this secret Tony Lake thing. You never hear about what's really happening. You get a little snatch of it, you know. Tony's going to do something on this. What do you think? He called me. He said, what do you think about such and such? And I went on the trip with Tony Lake because at the Pentagon, we had heard that Richard Holbrooke might be taking over this delegation. And Richard Holbrooke cast a very tall, long, dark shadow on the Pentagon. He was known as a kind of diplomat who loved to use the military. And so everybody in the Pentagon is like, you got to stop Holbrooke from bombing. He just wants to bomb things. He just wants to bomb. So I volunteered to go to be the Holbrooke stopper on the delegation. And it wasn't very long before I realized what an incredible genius he was and how good he was and how sensitive he was and smart he was at using this. And so we went through these negotiations together. I was his sort of right-hand guy. I was like the puppet. I was on the puppet master's knee. He would tell me what to say in these negotiations. I would say it, and then he would say, be careful, Milosevic is trying to use you. Milosevic was a very clever guy. I was in uniform, and Milosevic would look at Holbrooke, and he didn't like Holbrooke. He didn't trust him. He was tricky guy, but I was military. Military is like dog. They're smart, not so smart, but loyal. And so he would manipulate me. He'd look at me and talk and smile at me, and he smiled. He would blow smoke at Dick and look daggers at him, you know. And you could see him working in the delegation. And so we worked this through, and we had some interesting times on it. Dick was very good at using the intelligence. He got intelligence, John, I think you gave him personally. I'm not sure I got that intelligence, because when you're dealing with intelligence, you never know what you don't know. Somebody always has something else that, you know, you look up there and say, how does he know that? I said, because, you know, he got limited distribution intelligence. So Dick was very, very good. He was very well prepared. A couple of incidents that illustrate this. So we were, when the bombing was occurring, Milosevic, we landed there. He took us to a hunting lodge out from Belgrade, and he said, let's take a walk around the lake. So Dick and I took the walk around the lake with Milosevic, and he said, this bombing must stop. It's very bad for peace. Of course, that's what led to the letter, because it was obvious that we had him right where we wanted him. When you've got your adversary claiming that you've got to stop the bombing so he can negotiate, say, no, that's why, send more bombs, right? So we go back the next time, and he says, I have a special surprise for you. I think, oh, maybe a cake or something. And he produces Mladic and Karadzic, the two indicted recently indicted war criminals are there. And so we go into this lodge, and this is the time, the bombing's still going on, and this is the time to make peace. And Milosevic, in his grandiose way, says, "Please, gentlemen, you must agree among yourselves how to make this peace and make this bombing stop." And so we're sitting around this room and in the hunting lodge, and before I know it, Milosevic leaves, before anything really is said. And then Dick gets up to leave. And before I know it, I'm left with Mladic and Karadzic. And I'm not a trained lawyer, and I have to be honest with you, they never taught me at West Point how to write a ceasefire agreement. I knew how to do an op plan. I didn't know how to write a ceasefire agreement. So, you know, it was the second night without sleep. One night across the Atlantic, one night at Pamela Harriman's residence, and an all-night flight, and this was the third night without sleep. And we wrote this ceasefire agreement, and so it was what, you know, Dick wanted, and he used it, and he was very effective because he let me take the heat for the ceasefire agreement, and he could backstop me on it. Because if he had done it himself, it would have put the delegation in jeopardy. He was very smart about how he deployed assets, and it did stop the fighting, it stopped the bombing, and it opened the door for the peace agreements. So we couldn't have done any of that without great intelligence. I just want to say that. And I want to also say to John, I want to reinforce what he said about the difficulty of this, because you've got to get the military deployment, the military organization on the ground correct. We had no military on the ground, so you're saying, we're saying that, what company is that, what battalion is that? We got UN units from different countries, we got Serbs, we got Muslims, we got Croats, we got paramilitaries in there, and they're all jabbering, and we're monitoring some of it, and we're hearing it from other people, and somehow that had to be kept straight. And then you had to know the commanders and what their will was, and then you had to know the political level, and then you had to know the other nations level. So it was a huge intelligence load on that. And the only suggestion that I had after all that, when I come back on it, and I don't know if we're doing this any better, but we're not very disciplined in the Pentagon, at least, about collecting information from people who've gone out. And we should be more disciplined. I mean, somebody should have made me, should have chained me to that desk when I came back and said, write down the name of everybody you talk to, every personality, tell me the five most important things and give me his strengths and weaknesses. Because I do believe that the Chinese do this, the Soviets did this, the Israelis do this, and for some reason, and I think the State Department does it, but for some reason in the military, we don't. We just want to know about weapons and stuff.
I suspect Joe will take you up on that offer.
Yeah. So we just want to know about weapons and stuff. So we don't get into the personalities and the details. We don't keep track of it. That's the only suggestion. As I'm thinking back on this whole episode, if we could have done that with everybody who'd ever met these guys, we would have really had a library on them, and it would have really supplemented the current take on the intelligence.
Thank you very much. Now to Madeleine Albright, who was both a cabinet member and a UN ambassador in the first term, and then of course our Secretary of State in the second term, so is very aware of how important intelligence is and how important US leadership is. And she was one of the earliest advocates, probably the earliest advocate, actually, for stronger U.S. leadership in the Balkans. And I think history is proving quite clearly that she was on the right side of history before many were. And in the documents that have been released today, they document how she was pushing and pushing and pushing. And there's one that was in February of 93, so we'd been there maybe a month. And she's in a principals committee meeting, which is the cabinet level interagency meeting, saying that our policy was legitimizing ethnic cleansing. This is a woman who does not mince words, and calling our policy pallid. So there's some wonderful quotes in these documents. But throughout the early days of this policy being developed, she was trying to keep the pressure on the need to recognize this was ethnic cleansing. We had to stay there. We had to keep the process of justice and ending the genocide at the forefront. And she was not afraid to put the use of force on the table, and did so early on and repeatedly to some fireworks in the Situation Room at times. But I wanted to start with your role in the Srebrenica crisis a little bit later, and your role at the UN, and how important the role of intelligence was in shocking the world of the conscious, your Adlai Stevenson moment.
Great, well, thank you. And it's wonderful to be back here together with this whole team. We really were a team, and it's great to see so many people, and Bruce, it's great to see you here. You know, people ask me what I miss most. It's not the airplane, it's the intelligence. Because I really do think that having that opportunity every day to have the kind of intelligence that the intelligence community can put together is totally amazing. Problem was, when I first began, I didn't understand why my briefer would sit there and watch me read, and I thought, I wondered if she was watching to see if I moved my lips when I read. But mostly it was in order to be able to then get the questions that then begin to move the process forward. Before I get to Srebrenica, let me just say this. It's interesting in listening to my colleagues. I do think it makes a difference what your background is, what your history is. Everybody has told a little bit of theirs. Mine is completely different. I was born in Czechoslovakia, and just by accident, my father was the Czechoslovak ambassador to Yugoslavia. Therefore, I understood Serbo-Croatian. I knew what the area was about. I understood the ethnic things. It's a pure accident of history that happened, that would have been the major issue that was out there that, in fact, we had to deal with. Along with Iraq sanctions, we had to deal with that. And I came, most of my colleagues are younger than I am, and they are very much a part of the Vietnam generation. I am a product of muting. When Neville Chamberlain said, why should we care about people in faraway places with unpronounceable names? So we all come with our own background, and I think that it is important as one studies history and decision making, what is it that you bring as an individual to it? The role of the individual really is different and I think matters. The other part that I think really matters in decision making, and these documents really show it, it is very, we all argued, and that's actually what it's supposed to be about. Principles committees, you shouldn't have everybody there saying yes sir, yes sir, but a really good national security advisor. Nancy has been through all of it. Sandy was a brilliant national security advisor. He made us break the eggs in order to really understand what was going on and that it was okay to disagree. That was the whole point. And if you look at these particular documents, you can see us disagreeing. So I disagreed. And I came at it from a very different aspect, not only my background, but also being at the UN, where I saw more different diplomats than any other American diplomat. You mentioned Pamela Harriman, she saw more French people, but I saw more different diplomats. And every single day, people would come up to me and say, your president, who as candidate said we were supposed to do something, why aren't you doing something? What is it? And we talked about the safe areas, and we talked about who was doing what. So that was going on one level. And then on another level, the Europeans were completely obnoxious because it was in Europe. And they, at one and the same time, were saying, why don't you let us do it? And then they didn't do it. So it was a very difficult and complicated aspect. What did happen on Srebrenica, which I think is very important, is that it was the marriage of policy and the image. And John, you talked about the images. And what had happened, we'd gone through these endless debates about the safe areas, which were never really safe, and partially how they were to be protected. And then all of a sudden, the safe area was overrun. And it was hard to persuade people what had really happened. So having gotten the intelligence in a variety of ways in different places, there were two streams that came together. One was that it was possible to interview somebody that had in fact been a Muslim Bosnian who had survived Srebrenica. a young man that had hidden under some bodies and was able then to come out and tell the story of what he had seen happening in Srebrenica. And then we were able to have, there were photographs, images that showed what had happened. First, a lot of people in a field, in a stadium. Then there had been an empty area. Then there had been an area where all of a sudden you could see people all over the place. Then there were tracks taking the people out of it. And so I managed, through all my friends here, to get these images declassified. And I took them to the Security Council. And there had been all these discussions of had it happened, had it not happened, what had the Dutch been doing. And then I passed the pictures around the Security Council. And it was silent as people kind of looked at these pictures, which told the story and matched the story of the interviews that the young man had given. And it was really chilling to everybody. It was an amazing example of how you can use intelligence really to push something forward. It was kind of my Adlai Stevenson moment. But it was a perfect example of how these two things, the policy and the intelligence, came together, and it has to be visible in some particular way. So I think that was very good. The War Crimes Tribunal, you talked about that too, John. It's very important. I was proud of many things I did at the UN, but one was one of my early votes to create the War Crimes Tribunal. David Sheffer worked with me. And part of my, I have to tell you, I'm usually known as multilateral Madeline, but the bottom line is multilateralism is very hard. It's also, Americans don't like the word, it has too many syllables and ends in an ism. But mostly it is just partnership and trying to get others to go along. But the UN is difficult, there's no question about it. I think that trying to get the countries to agree, the Russians are not usually helpful. And we're protecting the Serbs in any number of different ways. We saw that in spades on Kosovo. But basically, I think that the question is how you get them mobilized. And so the War Crimes Tribunal was a very important part of a really new step in terms of trying to get those that were perpetrating the crimes, very different from Nuremberg, where this had already been a surrendered power. We knew that people talked about that as the model, whereas the War Crimes Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia was something totally different. So it was a very early vote that we took. Then the question was, how could we prove what was going on? And I think that the way of supplying some of our intelligence information to them in order to get indictments was a very important part. The difficult part about it was that not all of the UN system trusted our intelligence, or they liked our intelligence, but they weren't sure, they just only wanted to use our intelligence. So I think that became a very important issue. But I do think that ultimately the combination of the sanctions, and I have to say, Leon and I really, you look for allies within the Principals Committee, and I've got to say that Leon and I were very well allied on this. And the sanctions, I think, were very important, but the indictments were also from the War Crimes Tribunal. And that combination of aspects, and then the bombing, and by the way, it was very interesting. I have to say, I admire General Powell incredibly. Arguing with him is difficult as a mere mortal female civilian. As he testified in his book that he had to explain patiently to Ambassador Albright that our soldiers were not toy soldiers. And he then, I called him after the book came out, and we had actually used force positively after he left. And I said, Colin, patiently? And he said, yeah, I had to explain it to you patiently. You understood nothing. And so he sent me his book, and he signed it with love, admiration, et cetera, patiently, Colin. So I wrote him back a note, and I said, with love, admiration, et cetera, and I signed it forcefully, Madeline. But I think that Sholly really did bring a different approach. And I also think, as you said, Wes, I think some of it was his background. I think he came from a different kind of, and there was a time that Sholly and I were standing in front of the Situation Room, he in his uniform and me with my pin, and Bob Rubin walked by and he said, force and diplomacy. And Sholly said, and which is which? So, but we were very good partners in this, and as Sandy said, force and diplomacy really do go together, and I think those are the lessons with the addition, you cannot do it without the intelligence. And I think that the task force has been an amazing model And I feel really, as somebody that was able to use it in a way that maybe others couldn't, in pictures, that really proved the point and I think made the difference on a lot.
I just have to tell one of my favorite moments in the Situation Room with Madeline and General Powell, when he was making this argument that we have to have 500,000 troops to go into Bosnia, and Madeline said, "Colin, what do we have this glorious army for if we can't use it?" Yeah. And in his book, he said, "I almost had an embolism."
Patiently.
I have one more.
Let me open it up. All right, we've got a couple minutes for a discussion, and then we'll save a few minutes at the end for some questions. So let me just invite.
So just to say how dynamic this relationship with the intelligence community is. So there was a Sunday morning that we went in to see Tuđman. The fighting had gone.
Tell them who Tuđman is.
The Croatian president. The fighting had raged across the Krajina. And it was out of the Krajina. There were refugees out there and so forth. And Dick had communicated to Sandy, I guess, that it was time to stop the fighting, that it was too dangerous because of the Posavina and the threat of the Serb intervention. So he and Chris Hill went in to see Tuđman, and I was sent in to see the defense minister, Gojko Šušak, also known as the pizza man, because he had become wealthy in Canada with a chain of pizza restaurants. So we went in there. It was dark in the Ministry of Defense. We walk in, and the intelligence we have is we know where the front line is that we've been told from the previous day. And we walk in, and we tell Minister Šušak, the instructions are from the United States, you must stop, and you must stop those forces right now. And we said, Ambassador Holbrooke is giving this to President Tuđman right now. So Šušak says, stop, we're on the last hill overlooking Banja Luka. The Serbs are going crazy. They're shooting their own soldiers who are running from us. You want us to stop right now? We said, stop right now. So we get back in the plane, and so Dick has told Tuđman to stop, and we've told Šušak to stop, Jim Pardue and I, and we say, but look, did we know it was this bad? It was this bad. So, you know, we're scrambling to get the intelligence information to put it together. I guess Dick finally got the word that it was bad. He said, we should go to Milosevic right now and tell him to surrender. Right now, we can save his units. Right now, this is the moment. So we had to go to Italy for something. We detoured back. We get into Belgrade about 10 o'clock at night. We've already had dinner. We are in the sedan with the U.S. ambassador, and we say to the U.S. ambassador, we say, God, I can't believe we're going to go see him this late at night. He's going to make us eat another one of these heavy dinners with all these meats and everything. He's always making you drink the wine, and he serves three kinds of meat, and he keeps you up all night. Maybe can we just tell him we don't want to eat? So we know not to talk about anything in the sedan because we assume it's bugged. We go up. He greets us at the front door of the presidential mansion. He says, gentlemen, please come in. It's late. I'm sure you don't want to eat this late. And then he says, so we are not prepared to surrender. We have put General, and he named some Serb general, in charge. He is good man. He will fix this problem. Just like that. So you wonder, you know, the intelligence is a competitive business. So we had intelligence. He had intelligence. And I don't know where he got intelligence, but it was pretty spooky that night.
Let me just ask you all one question before we open it up. We're going to end it promptly at 3 o'clock, so get your questions ready. What comes through in listening to you all are your leadership, President's leadership, great intelligence, and a sense of the CIA pulling together this task force is very people-driven. And are there, in addition to the Bosnian task force, which is a bureaucratic thing, are there institutional mechanisms that you would recommend to your successors to maybe not have to reinvent the wheel the next time we have a similar crisis? Nobody has a invade Rwanda or invade, you know, Bosnia, Kosovo campaign off the shelf. You always have to invent it on the fly. The Pentagon doesn't sit around and say, okay, if this crisis happens, here's our plan. Assume the intelligence does exactly that, right? So, but, you know, it always is a little bit on the fly. So are there institutional thoughts for those who come after us to think about in terms of trying to be ready faster and more forcefully?
Well, I think that the issue here is trying, the hard part, I think, is how to involve as many layers of the system as possible without slowing everything down. I think that is the problem, because I think there is a tendency to get so many layers because you don't know where you're getting the information, and the decision making gets slow. So I do think that one of the things, as I go through these documents, is there began to be, and Sandy, you said it, the pressure came from the top. Ultimately, that is what has to happen, is the president has to say, I want a decision on this. And you can write as many memos as you want till you're blue in the face, but the bottom line is, that it would be my sense about all this, is this all changed because President Clinton decided that he was going to do something about it, and then he got the system moving.
Let me just pick up on that. We're here in this wonderful Clinton library, and I want to bring this back to President Clinton, if I can. You know, there are more than 40 paces between the Situation Room and the Oval Office. Rarely do National Security Advisors get fired if things go wrong. But presidents do get thrown out of office if things go wrong. And I can assure you there was no more appetite for American boots on the ground in 1995 than there is in 2013. We'd gone through Somalia, Black Hawk Down. We didn't have a great experience in Haiti. There was no appetite in the country for putting 25,000 or 20,000 troops into Bosnia, even in the context of a peace agreement. Most people couldn't tell you where Bosnia was on the map. Inevitably, the peace agreement would be shaky. And it was an extraordinarily courageous decision, I think. And we would not have had the peace. That was the centerpiece of the end game. Because once we said, we will be there to enforce the peace, that was the key decision. Then the parties had confidence that maybe a peace agreement actually could last. So it does ultimately come down, I think, to presidential leadership here. And you know, a decision the president made, I think, that was purely his judgment about what was in the best interest of the United States, of Europe, what was the best thing to do in terms of our security and in terms of our values. And I, you know, that's the lesson, the fundamental lesson that I take away from this.
Okay, let me open it up for questions. And I'm sorry, Leon, go ahead. Use your mic.
This will be real quick. You've been all collectively very kind talking about what I was able to do. Just remember that I was there on the Vice President's dime, and as a senator, 2 years before he had any inclination or idea that he was going to wind up as Vice President of the United States, you will find a speech that he delivered on the floor, followed shortly by Senator Dole. Those were the very two first senatorial comments saying that what was going on in the former Yugoslavia was not acceptable to the United States and why. And I still hope that we will one day get back to that level of clarity and collaboration across the aisle, because that too is essential for success.
Okay, I would say we'll take two questions at a time so we have a chance to get a couple in. And there was a woman. woman in blonde right there in the back with the glasses.
Oh, I'm Carolyn Staley, and a personal memory that we enjoyed in our family that connects to this is our daughter was a rookie reporter for ABC in Greenwood, Mississippi, and was home for Thanksgiving and had asked President Clinton if she could interview him in 1995, just after Thanksgiving. And he agreed, and he announced, in typical fashion, to help her little career along and to get her onto Peter Jennings' nightly news as the lead story that the U.S. would be sending troops to Bosnia. And I remember the personal sweetness of that, and but also the gravitas of it, because there had been such resistance to U.S. troop involvement in Bosnia. I didn't realize until I read the booklet that was handed us that this was after Dayton and that they were sent to help enforce the peace. Can you comment on what the dynamic of that decision-making process was to send troops?
Just one more right there in the front, and then we'll take those two. The man with the glasses and the beard.
Thank you for coming. My name is Sean, and I'm a student at the Clinton School of Public Service. In McMafia, Misha Glenny makes the argument that the sanctions were a big mistake because by putting the arms embargo and the sanctions against Serbia, it forced every government in the region to get all of their military supplies and economic activity had to go through criminal channels. And he argues that it basically gave rise to modern transnational post-Soviet organized crime like Prohibition did in the US. And I was just wondering, did the intelligence community see that coming? Did you report on it during 1991 to 1995? And given what we know now, do you think that the trade-off was worth it?
Okay, we have two questions. Leon, do you want to take the last one?
First of all, we're running this on the basis of a set of declassified documents. I can go only so far as the light shed by those documents permits me to go. So that question is another time, maybe for another set. But I do want to say that one of the consequences of sanctions is a disruption among society, including disruptions among the innocent. I mean, when you cause massive inflation through sanctions, it's the middle class that bears the brunt in any, or the very poor that bear the brunt in any given country. I mean, we had to deal with such issues as the availability of heating oil for sanitaria in Serbia and elsewhere during the winter months. So there were always consequences that were not desired that had to be dealt with on the fly by the decision-making process. Now, if you think that the choice is between effectively operating the sanctions, doing nothing, or switching immediately to the use of force, I would say that one uses the sanctions fully aware of side effects. It's strong medicine.
Madeline?
Can I, on the sanctions, I teach at Georgetown, and I've made up a course. I say foreign policy is just trying to get some country to do what you want. That's all it is. So what are the tools? And there are not a lot of tools in that national security toolbox. There is diplomacy on one end and use of force on another and various gradations. Sanctions are a very important economic tool, and the 90s was very much known as the sanctions decade. It was very interesting because I think that one of the other things I did at the UN was to try to make sure that sanctions stayed on Iraq. That was how the ceasefire had been translated into a series of sanctions, and those were very kind of ham-handed sanctions, if I might say, the toughest sanctions on any country at all. And what we were looking at through Leon's help was try to really get more surgical with the sanctions on the former Yugoslavia. One of the problems that was there, because you put two things together, is that there was an arms embargo that was put on that only hurt the countries that had seceded from the Serbs. The Serbs continue to have, they had a really huge standing military, and the reason that we wanted to lift those the embargo on arms was that the others weren't getting any. So there are two different aspects to this. But sanctions are a tool, and they do hurt. And the question is how you turn to what are known as smart sanctions to just the comprehensive ones. I think on the other question, Sandy, you probably on the... I mean, these documents are fascinating
the thing I would
in
say
terms
is,
of that
is
discussion.
That, when you're designing a strategy like this, you start with the question of whether you're prepared to use force and then work backwards. That's the first thing you answer. And then you design your strategy to that decision, rather than designing your strategy, make the threat, and then decide whether you're prepared to use force. So once the president made that decision that he was prepared to deploy troops under these circumstances, we then backed up and decided that we could use that as leverage to convince the parties that if they actually reached an agreement, there would be a chance that there would be a good chance the agreement would be used, and to go to the other NATO countries. Our 25 or 20 turned out to be was part of a 60,000 person NATO force that was deployed in Bosnia, actually much longer than we thought it was going to be deployed, and that, you know, that became extremely important to the confidence of the parties that if they agreed to some kind of an agreement that would end the war.
Wes?
So just on the sanctions piece and analyzing the utility of sanctions as a tool, it's true that you may give some incentive to these networks to form and learn how to smuggle. But I do a lot of work in Eastern Europe. There's been a lot of declassified documents now made possible by going into the Stasi files and the KGB files. There's a book on Romania that's very instructive that was just finished this fall where he goes through this entire analysis. These countries are rife with intelligence services. In Eastern Europe, one out of every three people speaks for some other nation's interest. Those intelligence networks, then at the end of the Cold War, they dissolved, they became something else. They became business networks, agent networks for influence by Russia today and so forth. You can't blame the emergence of those networks on sanctions. Sanctions had this much impact on something that was going to be there in any case and is there in full force today. But one thing sanctions did do is it forced these newly democratic governments to lead and take a stand that was not easy for them. And it paid off later on. So in the case of Bulgaria and Romania, during the Kosovo campaign in 1999, we required Kosovo and Bulgaria not only to keep the sanctions on at that point, they were besieged with requests from Serbia to let war material go through there. And they didn't. And they had the means to stop the war material. They cut off any hope of Russian war material reaching Serbia during that campaign. And they did it because they wanted to be NATO members later. But they also did it because they had practiced it with the sanctions earlier. So sanctions cut both ways, but they do strengthen governments.
Okay, with that, I apologize. We have to break because the president will be here shortly. And I want to just thank the CIA for putting this on for the Clinton Library, and most of all, our panel, Leon, Sandy, Wes, and Madeline. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome President Bill Clinton.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I was upstairs watching the panel. I had it piped in. And I was thinking, it's no wonder we got a few things right. I had so many smart people working in the administration. So I'd like to begin by thanking Stephanie Street and the Presidential Center, and thank you, Terry Garner and Jill Lampert, for your opening remarks and for all the work you did to make this day happen. I also want to thank John Gannon and Gene Tissinger from the CIA, and Madeline, Sandy West, Leon, and Nancy. I thought you were wonderful. I love the panel. I was upstairs hanging on every word. I presume all of you got one of these books, and if you did, I urge you to read it. If you read this, you don't have to pay attention to what I'm about to say. You'll know what this day is about. I want to thank some people who aren't here. I want to thank the late Secretary of State Warren Christopher for the work he did at Dayton. I am very grateful to Dick Holbrooke, and I miss him. He was a massive force. On my birthday in 1995, I walked off the golf course in Wyoming to learn that Joe Kruzel, Bob Frazier, and Nelson Drew had lost their lives in the search for peace in Bosnia. And I thank Sandy for being here today. They and Wes were on that dangerous road because Slobodan Milosevic would not guarantee them safe air traffic into Belgrade. And so they had to take that road. Wes Clark and I have been friends for 45 years. We met at Georgetown in 1967. He used to stop through Arkansas on his way to some new duty post. And I watched him rise. I was terrified that my election as president would mess up his Army career because people would think I had something to do with some advance he made. I never had anything to do with anything he got. He got it all on his own merits, some of it in spite of the fact that we were friends. He's done a lot of things for our country, but nothing touched me more than when he raced down the side of that mountain trying to save his colleagues in a burning car. I woke up in the middle of the night last night and I couldn't go back to bed. I relived Bosnia from start to finish. I miss Ron Brown and Chuck Meisner and all the people at the Commerce Department and all the business leaders who died on a mountainside in Croatia in a plane crash on a mission trying to rebuild Bosnia economically. And I have often wondered if they had lived whether there would have been enough economic progress to melt some of the stubbornness that persisted at the end of the war. I want to thank Al Gore for giving me Mr. Sanctions Leon Firth and giving him to the country and for being really tough. Wes Clark's pay on to John Shalikashvili, whom I'm also grateful for, who is no longer with us, was absolutely true. But he will also tell you, not all the military felt the way they did. And after we got the peace agreement and we had to send a peacekeeping force in, it was Al Gore that got everybody in a room and reminded them that we were all on the same team and we better begin to act accordingly. That's what a vice president's for, to be the bad cop. And when he had to be, he was great at it. I want to thank a lot of other people whom I'll mention along the way who are no longer here. I'd like to make one general point. One of the things that I try to emphasize when I wrote my memoirs is that when you're president, everything happens at once. We finished the Bosnian Peace Accord in November of 1995 in the middle of the two government shutdowns, after one and before the next one. Quite appropriate for today, don't you think? 1995 was a big year. We restored President Aristide, the democratically elected leader of Haiti. We finally got the ceasefire in Northern Ireland, which led 3 years afterward to the Good Friday Accord, which still is held today through good times and bad. We got the Bosnian Peace Agreement. We had the largest handover of land from the Israelis to the Palestinians in the West Bank, and it cost my friend Prime Minister Rabin his life 3 years later, three weeks later. Ron Brown's plane crashed in 1995. Oklahoma City occurred in 1995, raising all kinds of other questions about intelligence and the relationship of those who collected intelligence abroad and those who collected it at home, how it should be shared, and what should be done. Meanwhile, Boris Yeltsin was trying to preserve his position as a true Democrat, small d, in Russia against opponents who wanted a more authoritarian future, either going back to communism or forward with a kind of ultra-nationalism that would recreate in their own minds a 20th and then 21st century version of a Russian empire. Meanwhile, we were also seeing the emergence of terrorism justified by Islamic politics and certain interpretation of religions. We already had the first World Trade Center bombing in 93, remember? And the people who were getting pummeled in Bosnia were Muslims. It was a source of concern to people all across the world. I received calls from both the Pope and the King of Saudi Arabia asking me to intervene in Bosnia. And I wondered whether that was the first time they had ever been on the same side of an issue. Dick Holbrooke said it was the problem from hell. And when we were once discussing how everything happens at once, the aftermath of Somalia, Haiti, Bosnia, Tony Lake cracked one of his best lines the whole time he worked in the White House. He said, you know, sometimes I really miss the Cold War. Bosnia, in some ways, became a metaphor for the struggles of the 21st century. It was the first conflict which reminded us that the end of the Cold War basically took the veil off this image we were privileged to have, even when it didn't fully comport with reality, that there was a bipolar world, and as dangerous as it was, with all these nuclear weapons hanging around, at least it was organized. Even our spies helped each other, I used to say. If the Russians were better off if the spies in the Cold War for America were really good, because that way we knew their intentions and we knew they didn't mean to launch a nuclear weapon at us. And we were better off if the Russian spies were really good, because that way they knew we didn't intend to blow them off the face of the earth. Now, it was hard to convince anybody whose life was on the line working for the CIA or the KGB that it was a good thing if the other side was good at what they did. But we had the illusion that power could be organized, constructed, controlled, and directed for good and bad ends. Bosnia was a beginning of showing us how incredibly dispersed power was going to get in the 21st century. Weapons everywhere. Sort of a global version of the extreme interpretation of the Second Amendment. They're everywhere. And there's wide dispersal of information and the ability to use it in a thousand different ways, thanks to the social media, the cell phones. You can send money and information everywhere in an instant. And so now, everywhere you see these conflicts between the forces of integration, trying to hold things together, and the forces of disintegration. The world is interdependent for good and ill. The distinguished author Moses Naim has written a book called The End of Power, which I recommend to all of you, which doesn't really say there's an end of power. It just says that there's an end of power in terms of being able to get it, use it, and keep it without other people who seem to be powerless messing with your exercise. Sometimes we cheer that, sometimes we grieve over it. I thought my job when I got elected, as embodied by the commitment I had to stop the ethnic cleansing and the slaughter in Bosnia, was to try to create a world in which people who were trying to put together things had a better chance to win than those that were trying to tear them apart, but in which we would not put back together the old dictatorships that characterized the Cold War. That we would create a new world of freedom and prosperity and cooperation that we would share. In a world where everything is happening at once, intelligence is really important because it is impossible for any one person, no matter how many newspapers and magazine articles you read and how many people you talk to on the telephone, to have real-time knowledge in the areas where you have to make decisions. So as a general proposition, before we get to what happened in Bosnia, which was, I think, very special from an intelligence point of view, it's just important. It really matters. Look how the year started, 1993, when we started working on this. First thing I had to worry about was Yeltsin was under siege. He had risked his life, if you remember, by standing up on a tank in Moscow to tell the Russian army, you may take us back to the bad old days, but you'll have to kill me to do it. The son of a Russian immigrant happened to be seated by me at dinner this summer when Hillary and I went to a dinner with a bunch of our friends. And he looked at me and he said, did you like Yeltsin? And he said it just like that. I said, yeah, I did. He got a big smile on his face. He said, good. He said, my country in its entire history has only produced two true Democrats, Alexander Kerensky and Boris Yeltsin, and Lenin got rid of Kerensky, and you helped Yeltsin to stay. Too bad we lost it again, but maybe we can get it back. It was an incredible conversation. So Russia was going broke like crazy at the end of the Cold War, so the first thing I did was to go to Vancouver and meet with Yeltsin and put together a $24 billion package so he could bring his soldiers home from other countries, principally the Baltic states. And you were talking about this before, the American people were 74% against my aid package to Russia. So what's Bill Clinton doing going to Canada to meet with a Russian leader? We got economic problems at home. And I also knew I needed his cooperation to keep from gumming up the works in Bosnia because of the historic ties of the Russians to the Serbs. So we did that. And you heard all this before, but America was basically supposed to stop this awful violence in Bosnia. miraculously acting on its own in a place where Europe was already heavily involved. Only European soldiers were on the ground in the UN peacekeeping force. There were no American soldiers on the ground. We were supposed to somehow go in there and fix it and do it without losing a single American life, without killing a single innocent bystander, and if possible, without killing anybody on the other side. In an environment where, at the time, our European friends were pushing a peace plan that all of us thought had no chance in the world to succeed, but made us feel like they didn't want to do it. We had a policy early on. We wanted to lift the arms embargo on the Bosnians because the Bosnian Muslims and the Croats couldn't get arms, and the Serbs had all the arms they needed, thank you very much, courtesy of Slobodan Milosevic in Serbia. And we wanted the authority to use airstrikes in early 1993. And Warren Christopher went to Europe, and the Europeans told him to go home. They had everything under control, and they had no intention of doing this. So we went home and went back to work. You remember that later, they've already talked about this in the panel, but we finally got slowly more involved with more permission from our allies to do what I wanted us to do together. First, we got permission to do humanitarian airdrops. They made a difference. And then Leon went to work on the sanctions that the UN supported. Then we had a safe area declared around Srebrenica, which worked until it didn't in 95, and 7,000 people were killed there. But they would not agree to raise the arms embargo, to lift it, because they said their soldiers on the ground would be in danger and ours wouldn't. And I was reluctant to go along with Senator Dole, who was a real champ on this issue, as has already been said. He wanted to lift the arms embargo unilaterally, but keep in mind, at the time, there were also arms embargoes on Haiti, Libya, and Iraq. And if the arms embargo in those places were lifted, it would have just the reverse impact of lifting it in Bosnia, where it would even up the score for the people who were trying to keep from getting slaughtered. In that place, those places, it would have only strengthened the people who were doing the killing. It was a terrible dilemma. And we had this team that just kept on plugging at it and kept on working at it. In 94, we finally got NATO approval, or UN approval, for NATO to conduct airstrikes under certain circumstances, but under a system euphemistically called the dual key, which meant that the NATO countries had to agree to do it, and so did the UN Secretary General. And that was a real problem, since Russia was on the UN Security Council. And we were afraid that we had a power that didn't exist. Then, in February, we finally got to use it because there was a no-fly zone. And when NATO pilots shot four Serbian planes down in February of 1994, it was the first time in the history of NATO that NATO together had ever conducted a military operation. And it was out of area. It was out of the territorial boundaries of the NATO members. Then in March, we got a big break. The Bosnians and the Croatians, who had also been fighting each other but over territory, resolved their differences, began to work together, began to fight against the Serbs, and that began ever so slowly to turn the war around. What had already been done, just with the authority for the no-fly zone, the safe area, the humanitarian efforts, took the casualty rate from 130,000 in 1992 to 3,000 in 1994. But the political problems and the underlying military capacity to kill people had not been resolved. So we kept working through 1995. Over time, the Bosnians and the Croats, when they started fighting after their peace agreement, only controlled 30% of the land of Bosnia, even though together they were more than 50% of the population. By the time we started the peace talks, they had gone from 30% to 50%. So we got a big break on the ground. So by the time our parties met in Dayton and the principles of peace had generally been agreed to, the Bosnians and the Croats actually had about what they would have under any negotiable peace settlement. That was important. Then in 1995, everything went straight back to what Dick Holbrooke called the problem from hell. Exemplified by first the slaughter in Srebrenica and then a second major shelling of the Sarajevo market, after which NATO launched a 21-day, 3,500 missile mission campaign that dealt with airstrikes and missile strikes and against that background, Dick Holbrooke, Wes Clark, and our whole team went about trying to get some agreement on basic principles to open peace talks. In November, Dayton occurred. We tried even then to build networks of cooperation. I knew we couldn't own Bosnia. This was America, not Europe. So the Dayton talks, I think wisely, included as co-chairs the Secretary of State of the United States, the European Union representative Carl Bildt, later Foreign Minister of Sweden, and the first Deputy Foreign Minister of Russia, Igor Ivanov. That was Strobe Talbot's job, keep the Russians happy. Easy little job. The result was the peace agreement that said there would be one unified country with an undivided Sarajevo as capital. The national government would have control over foreign policy, over monetary policy through a common central bank, trade and immigration, and each division, the Serbian Republic and the Bosnia-Croatian Republic, would have their own police forces and basically run their domestic lives. Then we had to sell it, including a peacekeeping force of 60,000, two-thirds of which would be supplied by 25 other countries, one-third by the United States. You heard them talk about that. As I remember, only about 60% of the people were opposed to us participating in that. I say that to make this point. The American people, particularly when they think things are not all well at home, hire their political leaders to act for them, but they know we have global responsibilities. Oftentimes, when a proposed course of action is unpopular, it's not exactly like the voters are telling you not to do it. It's basically like a giant blinking yellow light. They're saying, for goodness sakes, be careful. Tell us what our objectives are. Tell us when it's going to be over. And tell us what it's going to cost. And you better be right. In other words, if you win for America, we forgive you. If you don't, you own it. It ain't like we told you, we didn't tell you so. That's basically what these polls mean. You cannot make foreign policy decisions by polls. You just can't do it. 80% of the people, parenthetically, were against my helping Mexico when we gave them a loan, again in 1995. Everything happened that year. And we had just lost the Congress. People thought I was nuts. And so I asked, this is what you have to think about with Bosnia and with all these other issues. So we don't make the loan to Mexico and they go broke. And they hate us. And so does the whole rest of Latin America. And the next year, we have another million illegal immigrants and billions of dollars more of drugs flowing across the border, and chaos reigns everywhere. And people ask me, why did you let this happen? And I say, because on the day I had to make the decision, there was a poll that said 80% of you were against it. See how absurd that sounds? So the president in international affairs gets hired not only to look down the road, but around the corner. You get hired to win for the country. You have to start with a goal in mind and work back and realize that the citizens understand that there's no way they can know as much about something as you do. They got their own lives to live and their own problems. But when they tell you not to do something, what they're really telling you is, be careful, please. Tell us as much as you can about what you're going to do. Don't do a lick more than you have to. Don't spend a dollar more than you have to. And you better be right. But it has nothing to do with the discharge of your responsibilities. I'm not sure that there were a majority against our restoring Aristide, a majority against Bosnia, a majority against the Russian aid package. There was a majority against our going into Kosovo. We didn't have a majority doing starting any of this. You just have to look down the street and around the corner and listen to the blinking yellow light and treat your citizens with respect. Tell them honestly what you're doing and why. So all this stuff is happening. And finally, we got the peace agreement at Dayton between the shutdowns. Then in December, we had a formal peace signing in Paris. My one and only chance to have a meal with Slobodan Milosevic. And I sat down across the table with him. Madeline and Sandy and I have talked about this a lot. Milosevic was intelligent, articulate, cordial, and the coldest man I ever met in my life. I have never looked into darker eyes in my life. He was also rather paranoid. He knew that I had been a very close friend of Itzhak Rabin. He'd been dead only about a month. And he said, you know he was killed because he was betrayed by a member of his intelligence service. And by the way, that's why Kennedy was killed too. You guys just did a better job of covering it up. Everybody was always out to get somebody in Milosevic's mind. And that justified any kind of thing he did to kill anybody he killed. The price of victory and the way we pursued it was high. The estimates of those killed has ranged anywhere from 1 to 300,000. Everybody knows there was more than 2 million refugees who were driven out of their homes. The peace is endured, but unity remains elusive. Just today, they're having a meeting about whether Bosnia and Herzegovina can be taken into the European Union. And the answer is probably not now, because they haven't been able to form the kind of national institutions necessary to exercise full membership, as the Serbs still try to join some greater Serbia. But the peace is endured. We also, to go back to what I said at the beginning, had the peace endure while maintaining our relationship with Russia. We expanded NATO. We took in new members. We had more than 40 affiliated countries in a partnership for peace. We had a special agreement with Russia and with Ukraine to cooperate with them. We got Ukraine and Kazakhstan and Belarus to take their nuclear weapons out of their countries and put it back into Russia. And then under the Nunn-Lugar bill, we helped to control that. And during all these years, by the way, I spent a lot of your tax money to keep about half of the 40,000 Russians involved in nuclear, chemical, and biological work employed so they wouldn't go to work for somebody else who would do us ill. It was a good expenditure of your tax money. All that had to be considered in the context of Bosnia. And finally, we made an unequivocal statement by saving the largest community of Muslims in continental Europe, that we were not an anti-Islamic country. that America would take serious risks to keep innocent Muslims from being killed, and that we would work with and support any Islamic population that renounced terror and embraced reconciliation and cooperation. We were trying to do all this at once. Now you can readily see how important intelligence is. We had to know how much change Yeltsin could absorb. We had to know how reliable the efforts to move the nuclear weapons out of these other countries back into Russia were. All this while dealing with everything we had to know in Bosnia. And we had to do the right things in Bosnia and do it in the right way. I can't say enough about the intelligence apparatus that was set up to give us timely, quicker, briefer, more accurate reports on what was going on in Bosnia. And we had there, in their Balkan Task Force, the CIA, the Defense Intelligence Agency, the NSA, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, regularly working together. Sandy chaired a deputies committee that kept all the agencies working together. We were committed to sharing information, not hoarding it, to try to reconcile the apparent inconsistencies, and then to make good decisions. You know, I love all these shows, Homeland and all that stuff. I love that stuff. But the real world involves all these CIA folks out there killing themselves to figure out what is really going on and how to get that back to the policymakers. And what Leon says is right. You have to be an active, not a passive consumer of intelligence. Otherwise, someone just assumes that your bandwidth has been choked in 1994 and 95, and you wind up like we were, not even having a meeting about Rwanda because you're so obsessed with all this other stuff. So the obligation of the policymakers is to be aggressive in saying what we need. I also agree with the comments that were made in the panel about the need to have someone representing these intelligence forces in the room when you're making decisions so you can get more information. I suppose, this is just in my experience, the only time that the CIA went beyond that was when we were at Y River and before, when the director, then director of CIA, George Tenet, was an active partner with Mossad and the Palestinian intelligence services in promoting peace in the Middle East. But it's hard to quarrel with the results. 1998 is the only year in the entire history of the state of Israel when not one Israeli was killed by a terrorist incident, even though there was a prime ministerial election where the leadership of the country changed hands. So we're living in a world where it's easy to blur the lines. But I think it's important to recognize that what they did in Bosnia was of lasting and enduring benefit. And the cooperative mechanism that was established to share information and to do it in a responsive, straightforward way is a good role model that ought to be followed in the future. It's not one of those lessons, to quote one of the things in the book, that ought to have to be relearned. I like former Secretary of State Jim Baker very much, but when he said, in response to the trouble in Bosnia, we don't have a dog in that fight, I think he was wrong. We did have a dog in the Bosnian fight, and we still do. What was the end of the Cold War going to mean? The rise of chaos or the rise of democracy, prosperity, and cooperation? If you wanted it to be the latter instead of the former, no matter how thorny Bosnia had become, no matter how much blood had been shed, no matter how much determination there was for destruction, we had to get caught trying to do the right thing. We could not have said that we're going to end one century and start another with the first legacy in Europe, having endured two world wars, a depression and a Holocaust in between. The first thing we're going to say is we couldn't do a darn thing to stop ethnic cleansing. Secondly, as I said, I think it's important because it revitalized NATO. It proved that there was a post-Cold War mission for NATO. Thirdly, it was important because it proved we could manage a difference of opinion with Russia and bring them in, both into the peace talks at Dayton and into the peacekeeping post-conflict, which happened not only in Bosnia, but thanks to Bosnia, later in Kosovo. And finally, it helped us to send what I thought was a constructive message to the Muslim world that by our own moral standards was the right one because we were keeping innocent civilians from being slaughtered. We did have a dog in the Bosnian fight. And all these people you just heard from, the others I mentioned and some I have not, Peter Galbraith, Peter Darnoff, Chuck Redmond, lots of other people, they made sure that our dog won the fight. The peace has held. The future is up to the Bosnians. I think that the government documents which are being released today will show that. They'll show that the roots of the so-called ethnic cleansing were not as deep as people said. It's not true that the Bosnians had always hated each other. Sarajevo had seen Bosnians, Croats, and Serbs live together in relative peace for five centuries. What you had was a bunch of power-hungry, land-hungry politicians who thought that they could spark the deep well of insecurity that exists in all of us by making them fear the other. It's the same thing that happened between the Tutsis and the Hutus in Rwanda, the same thing that we see happening in the various places today. You'll see that if you read these documents that are being released. This was not some long-standing problem. This was a naked, cynical, cold-blooded, and bloody power play. You will also see the level of dedication and cooperation that all these people and those I've mentioned and others brought to their work. It will prove all over again that creative cooperation works best to solve complex problems. A few years ago, a journalist named James Sorowiecki wrote a book called The Wisdom of Crowds. And in a sentence, here's what the book concludes. Just look around this room. Suppose I could instantaneously do a measurement and find the person with the highest IQ. And we take all the rest of us and we go in another room and the person with the highest IQ goes in his or her own room. If you feed a series of problems in, one after the other, and ask for a response, over time the crowd will make better decisions than the genius. Even Einstein, who had the biggest measured brain we've ever seen. So the fact that they were smart to begin with and that they all worked hard made a big difference. That's the second thing that we learned. The third thing is that the cooperation on intelligence made all the difference. Because if you get bad facts and bad interpretations, you will make good decisions for the set of facts and interpretations you have, but it won't work in the real world. So again, I think you will see by the release of these CIA documents that they did a heck of a good job. And I feel very strongly that we should do more of this. I believe it's true that when I was president, I uncovered more documents than anybody else had, and I know I authorized the release of our own classified documents more quickly than ever before. In addition to this cooperative mechanism we have, while the Bosnian conflict was going on, in 1994, I issued an executive order that declassified 44 million pages of documents. Some of them had been kept secret going back to World War I. In a world where power is diffuse, you have to trust people with knowledge and be prepared to win arguments based on the knowledge available instead of trying to hoard it. In 1995, I issued an executive order which released images acquired by intelligence satellites that had scientific or environmental significance. This is a big deal to Al Gore. He had been trying to do this since 1990. And that had never been done before. There had never been any release of intelligence photography. And the world didn't come to an end. In fact, 90% of you didn't know it had ever happened. And the other 10% didn't know it was secret in the first place. We had to be very careful not to create an edifice of importance that blocks us from the empowerment of ordinary citizens in a democracy. We needed a bunch of this stuff to be secret while we were making the decisions. But after it was over, it's a good thing to let scholars and unvarnished, unbiased examiners look at these things. In 1995, we charged the CIA and other agencies to institute declassification programs. Before that, only 5% of all the classified documents kept by the government had to be released by a time certain. After that, more than 50%, it was assumed, had to be released within 25 years. Thanks to the CIA, we're way beating that 25-year deadline today. So I think all this is really important. And just from 1995 through 2000, 6 years, we declassified 800 million pages of documents compared to 188 million in the previous 15 years, including two of those were my years. We declassified about 25% of that. I believe this is an important part of maintaining the public trust. People have sense enough to know that you have to collect information that you don't want to broadcast. But they know they're paying for it, too. And they have also sense enough to know that as soon as the danger is past, we ought to give them the information so people can figure out whether we did the right thing with it or not, and what we could do better in the future. So this is a big deal that the CIA has done to have this event today. This is the earliest any of this information, this kind of information, has ever been released. You can say, oh, well, you guys like this because it worked out okay. And Madeline's story, she could have been even blunter than she was about some of the things she said and did that made her a hero to the rest of us. But believe me, what you will find when the time comes, all the documents that were to get released about Rwanda, is there aren't any to speak of. They're because we missed it. And nobody had to uncover any documents because I just admitted it. But that's another thing. I'll go back to the point Leon made. Why it's important to be a positive, not a passive consumer of intelligence. The CIA and every other intelligence agency knew that Bosnia was eating the world alive and threatened the whole future of Europe, and huge numbers of innocent people were dying over a prolonged period of time. In Bosnia, 800,000 people died in 90 days. It happened in a hurry. and we were preoccupied elsewhere, and we didn't do anything. I wish I didn't have to say that, but isn't that better than covering it up or trying to come up with some kind of a cock and bull explanation? And it does not in any way minimize the signal achievement of what was accomplished in Bosnia, because we had good intelligence, good people in all the relevant positions of authority and responsibility, and we did this together. And we gave Europe a chance to strengthen and broaden the European Union, to build a continent that was united, democratic, and at peace for the first time since nation states rose on the European continent, to end the slaughter of a Muslim minority that was called ethnic cleansing, while there was no biological distinction between the Muslims, the Croats, and the Serbs. It's just that it was in Sarajevo that the Ottoman Empire reached its northernmost point, the Holy Roman Empire that was Catholic reached its easternmost point, and the Orthodox Russian Empire that was Russian Orthodox reached its southernmost point. People arranged themselves accordingly and later killed themselves as if there were ethnic differences. It was all about politics and power. Nearly always when you find somebody strong killing somebody weak, the stated reason they do it is a lie. And one of the great gifts that Secretary Albright brought to the deliberations that we had here and in Kosovo and in the expansion of NATO and the support of a strong united Europe was a family history and a personal history of having seen some of those dramatic events unfold. So that's the story. Like all of history, there are many questions still pending, but the peace is held. Because a long time ago, with a lot of other things going on, good people were given good information and made good decisions. Thank you very much.